Hi, my name is Marsha, I'm the Blonde from Coding Blonde, and today I want to talk about women in tech. Did you know that women were the first ones to work on software? In fact, in 1960s, Cosmopolitan, yes, the same Cosmopolitan magazine that you know now, wrote an article about how the tech industry, well, the software industry, was perfect, the perfect environment for women. But how do we get to where we are now with so many stereotypes in the industry? Let's look at the history of women in tech. This is a remake of a video that I've already done at the beginning of my YouTube journey. I thought that this is a very important topic to highlight and wanted to do so again. So yeah, here's another video about women in tech and the history of women in tech. So to look at the history of women in tech, let's go back a few centuries. Did you know that the first programmer in the history of the world was a woman? Yes, it was Ada Lovelace who wrote the first algorithm in 1840. I've done a video about Ada Lovelace separately, so if you're curious to find out more about that, the link will be up here and in the description as well. Ada Lovelace was a badass. Check out that video after for sure. Are you familiar with the concept of human computers? Basically, what it means is a human who does mathematical computations. And back in the day, before computers were a thing, that's how people were getting their calculations for engineering purposes, missile launch, you know, the trajectory and all that stuff. And just in general, to create tables of different square roots and all that stuff. Well, I don't know if you're old enough. Or if you're Russian, you may have used those tables. I use those tables as a Russian student because they don't allow you to use calculators at some parts. Or they didn't used to. I feel old now. Okay, I'll stop talking. But basically, human computers did that. And the concept of human computers existed for a while. The first reference that has been found about human computers was back from the year 1613. And so, yeah, that's 17th century, a long time ago. And up until the Civil World War in the United States, human computers tended to be males, but starting from the Civil War, more females started to be hired because most of the women that got hired as human computers back then were widows trying to support themselves and their families. The society soon realized that this tedious manual task, these computations, can be done by women just as well as by men. And women were asking for a fraction of the salary that men would. So it was cheaper labor that could do the job just as well. And I don't know if that was the beginning of one of the factors that contributed to the current wage gap that we have in the technology, or, well, I guess in the world. But yeah, it may have been. I have no idea, so don't quote me on that. So by the 1940s, calculating became a woman's work, and they were calculating, like I said, ballistics, stuff for engineering, astronomy, and all that stuff. And these tasks were sometimes very important. So some of these women did amazingly important things for the society back then. For example, during the World War II, women calculated most of the ballistics, so the missile trajectories. And unfortunately, they weren't really recognized because their work was seen as below their male counterparts. And so they were never referenced. And a lot of this information, unfortunately, is lost in the history because they were just never mentioned. And we don't know about things that don't get mentioned. So math and programming go hand in hand. And back in the day, that's how you used to program a computer, with a mathematical statement that didn't really make sense to a human, but if you are a mathematical genius, you could understand it. So a lot of these human female computers were shifted towards programming. And the 1940s saw so many brilliant pioneers and inventors that were female. Those included Grace Hopper, Hedy Lamarr, Joanne Clark, Beatrice Worsley, and the six incredible female mathematicians who programmed the first general purpose computer called the ENIAC. Their names are Marlon Meltzer, Betty Holberton, Kathleen Antonelli, Ruth Tatelbaum, Jan Bartik, and Francis Spence. NASA, who back in the day was called National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics, was a major employer for female computers. There were many brilliant, prominent figures working there as well, including Dorothy Vaughan, Mary Jackson, and Katherine Johnson. I've recently watched a movie telling the story of these three incredible women. It's called Hidden Figures, and it's based on the book called Hidden Figures, The American Dream and the Untold Story of the Black Women Who Helped Win the Space Race. And I highly recommend this movie, and I haven't read the book yet, but it's on my list, so I'm sure the book is amazing. So I highly recommend checking that out if you're interested to learn more. Watching the movie was, I have goosebumps right now. It was so awesome to take a time machine back to those times and see how these incredible women were powering through and really getting ahead, doing what felt right to them despite all the hindrances they had that were there because of the society and how things worked back then. It's a brilliant movie. I highly recommend it. And I'm sure the book also goes into depth about it. As I said, it's on my list. It shows how human computers at NASA and female computers in general operated and what were their working conditions and all that stuff. And in particularly, it touches the subject of how Black women were treated back then and, you know, the conditions that they had that were very unfair because of the segregation that was happening in the society. But it's very motivational, it's very inspiring, highly recommended. Hidden Figures, remember, put it on your list, it's awesome. And in fact, last year, so in 2018, NASA has renamed the main road in front of its headquarters to honor those three women. It's now called the Hidden Figures Way. It's obviously referencing the book as well. Yeah, watch the movie, it's awesome. Unfortunately, Hidden Figures is the correct terminology to describe the incredible female pioneers, inventors, and just badass women back in those days, because their work wasn't attributed or recognized by the society. So we don't know about probably even a fraction of those incredible women. In fact, going back to the ENIAC computer that I mentioned earlier, when it was finally revealed and demonstrated to the public in 1946, those incredible six mathematicians and their teacher, Adele Goldstein, prepared the computer for the demonstration by writing some programs. But however, their work wasn't even mentioned or recognized at all during the public presentations. And after the presentations, there was a celebratory dinner and they weren't even invited to that dinner to celebrate the ENIAC computer that they were working on. It's crazy to me. And it just, yeah, I'm a little bit speechless when it comes to that, but it shows you how unfair the situation was back then and how these brilliant women weren't even recognized by the society. They literally were hidden figures. Back then, software was considered female work and hardware was considered male work. And I could list so many more brilliant women in the industry, at least the ones that we know of. Unfortunately, there are probably some information that has been lost because they weren't credited or attributed enough. But I want to go back to that Cosmopolitan issue in the 1960s and to how the software industry became male dominated. Here's a scan of the article that I'm talking about that was titled The Computer Girls. According to historian Nathan Ensminger, the scan below is taken from the April 1967 Cosmopolitan issue. I'll leave a link to this article if you want to actually read it in my description, along with all of my other resources if you're interested. So yeah, they're all going to be in the description. So that article talks about career opportunities for women in software in that industry and what a great environment it is for females and that it has great earning potentials for women. At the time, they were using a gender-neutral test called the IBM Programmer Aptitude Test that assessed logical reasoning and mathematical skills. So this test was used to select programmers, which meant that it was a field of truly equal opportunities for both male and female candidates. However, according to Professor Ensminger, around the time when this article was published, an irreversible process of masculinization of the industry has already begun. As the intellectual challenge of writing efficient code became obvious, employers started to train more male candidates to do the job. Writing code was no longer seen as a tedious job, and to raise the prestige or the reputation of the profession, a lot of professional associations were formed and educational requirements were introduced for the programming career. Women became discouraged to enter the field, and there were sexist ads floating around that were targeting employers. Here are some examples of those ads, and it's just painful to see those ads every time when I look at them. Furthermore, hiring standards were changing. A personality test, so a psychological personality test, was introduced that was created based on a research that was done with a sample of programmers. Only 15% of those were female, to understand the personality of satisfied programmers. And guess what? Some of the traits that these psychologists were looking for with this personality test were disinterest in people, and that these people disliked, and I quote, activities involving close personal interaction. Does this sound familiar? Well, that's how the stereotype of the antisocial programmer came about. It was manufactured. As you can see, women were almost pushed out of the software industry. It was a mainstream career choice up until the masculinization of the profession, which was essentially done through a PR campaign, if you really think about it. This resulted in a 19% drop in women who comprise computer science undergraduate majors, from 37% in 1985 to only 18% nowadays. This PR campaign, and yes, it is a PR campaign, let's completely be honest, it was just like almost a targeted pushing out of the industry. I don't know how to phrase it, but yeah, it still makes me kind of angry, but especially seeing those ads. But this PR campaign mixed with the fact that a lot of women in STEM fields that were pioneers, inventors, and all that stuff were not credited or recognized and lost in history isn't a great motivational factor for women nowadays. We need to believe in our abilities no matter what the stereotypes might be, no matter what the personality test says. Remember the amazing role models we still have left from history, and support each other, recognize each other and ourselves. So that's why I wanted to recreate this video, and why I created the Women in Tech weekly newsletter, to recognize, celebrate amazing women in the tech community, at least on social media right now, and also to share resources that might be helpful for other women. If you haven't seen the newsletter yet, the link will be in the description, and over there you'll be able to see all the recent issues of Women in Tech Weekly, and subscribe to the newsletter to stay updated and get those amazing celebrations in your inbox. I mean, that newsletter every Tuesday when it goes out makes me so happy, so inspired by these amazing women that are doing incredible things right now, today. And it's awesome to see how they end up connecting on social media as well. So yes, if you're a woman watching this, make sure that you share your news. And it can be anything. It can be from, I just got promoted, to I stuck with my meditation routine, or something like that. Something, you know, we need to celebrate our big wins, our small wins. We need to recognize each other and ourselves. Oh my God, I just want to give all the women a very big hug. So yes, if you have anything to share or any resources that you think would be helpful for women, also the link will be in the description for the submission form. Please comment in the comments below whether you know of any of these wonderful female role models. And if this video was a surprise for you, if you've known about this PR campaign, again, you can read all of my resources down in my description. So go do that right now if you're interested. Yeah, there are a lot of different very interesting articles down there. So make sure you read that. And if you are interested in the subject, let me know in the comments below, because then I'll create more material on that topic. Like this video if you've enjoyed it. Share it with somebody who needs to learn about this. Maybe a woman who is feeling like she's alone in the industry. But yeah, reassure her that she has so many great role models to look up to and that she's not alone. Share it, subscribe to my channel, and we can also be friends on other social media. You can find me as @codingblonde. Have a wonderful time of the day you're currently experiencing. Bye.